Yeah, you did the song with John B, the Are You Still Down song, right?
Are You Still Down, yeah.
And there's a demo clip of this song leaked on the internet, and it has the same beat as a Tupac unreleased song named Tongue Kissing.
Yeah.
And did you also did the engineering for the song Tongue Kissing?
I engineered the song, and again, that's why I say, man, that's what I told you, there's a lot of work out there that people probably don't know, because that Tongue Kissing song, when we worked on that, again, the engineering, I didn't mix the Tongue Kissing song, but I did mix the John B joint, and we thought it was done, and then a few weeks later, here come Tupac with John B's reps and John B, and John B is putting vocals on it, and I'm like, what? Okay, so, whatever. So
Tongue Kissing was recorded first.
Yeah, that's the original tune. That's the original joint on that beat.
Okay, and later on he re-recorded it with John B.
Yes.
So this song was recorded in the last months of his life as well, or was it done for All Eyes on Me?
No, it was done after All Eyes on Me, leading into to Makaveli.
Can you remember, or any samples were used on that song?
I could probably figure it out, but I haven't heard the song in so long. I don't know. I can almost guarantee that there's a sample in there,
yeah.
And it's not necessarily a sample. But what Johnny J learned to do was he would sample and have the sample in the song, but then you get real musicians, studio musicians, in to replay the sample, because getting clearance on a sample is super duper hard, but you can get mechanicals if you replay it. So mostly everything you hear that sounds like a sample is yes, it is a sample, but it's the recreation of a sample.
Okay.
Just that little part that he sampled, if it's a guitar riff or something, you bring in a guitar player and you try to get as close as you can to the original sound, and you just replay it. That's what he did. He did a lot of that, man.
Yeah, another song that you did was Unconditional Love, right?
Yeah.
And can you remember when this song was recorded?
The period was shortly after All Eyes on Me. Unconditional Love is shortly after All Eyes on Me, because, again, like I said, that was one thing about Tupac,
yeah,
is he kept working all the time. If he had 4 hours to work, he would get it in 4 hours. So it was shortly after All Eyes on Me, and sometime before we even thought about making Makaveli.
What is true about that the song was done for MC Hammer?
I'm not too sure about that question right there. I don't actually know who the song was done for.
Okay.
Or I really don't even know who it was done about.
Okay, because MC Hammer has a fair version of the song as well, and he said that it was Tupac gave it to him.
Yeah, he probably did, because they did have a cool relationship.
Yeah.
But I couldn't say, for sure out of the knowledge that I have. I don't know.
Okay. And do you know what happened to the master reel of this song? Because the version on Greatest Hits was just the kind of radio whip that they got from a radio station. They lost the master reel of the whole song.
I have no idea what happened to that master reel. It is, I have no idea what happened to a lot of the masters.
Yeah.
The reason being is because after, that situation over at Can-Am and Death Row and Tupac's demise and so on and so forth, they gathered all that material. We had a vault, dude. We had a walk-in vault with just tapes on everybody. So some artists had, you know, let's say 100 tapes. Some had 200, 300, 400, you know, and that's in the case of Tupac. So once they transferred all of that stuff from Can-Am to the storage facility over here in Burbank, God alone knows what happened, because a lot of the leaks, a lot of the radio leaks and stuff like that that was out there in the 90s, that started in the 90s, actually
came... Yeah, the Makaveli bootlegs.
Yeah, they all came during the transfer from, the actual transfer from Can-Am Records to the storage facility in Burbank.
So just some people sold the tracks to radio stations and radio DJs?
Yeah.
Probably, okay. Do you know anything about project that was called Westcoast Aftershock? There was a song supposed to be on that project that was named NY87.
That started after they came back from New York, doing New York, New York, and the dudes, and somebody out there shot at the dog pound. I specifically remember that song, NY87, the West Coast Aftershock. I definitely, I'm going to tell you who all was involved in that. That was DJ Pooh, DJ Quick, the Dog Pound, of course, all the Outlaws, Outlaw Immortals, a few, there was even a few East Coast rappers in on that.
Okay.
Yeah, that right there was, oh man, the vibe in the studio after that, oh my God, dude. Look, the story is the Dog Pound went to New York to film the video to New York, New York, and while on location, they got shot at.
Yeah,
so these guys comes back, and at the same time, you know, they come back, and the first thing they want to do is do this record. This in the East Coast, and that was one out of many songs that they did. You know, I don't know whatever happened to that record.
The company that bought Death Row, you know, Right Away.
Yeah, yeah, from Canada.
They released a Dog Pound album last year, and it had a version of the song NY87.
But,
It was a version without Tupac. This is the version I have, is with Tupac. There's a rumor that Tupac edited himself later after the track was recorded.
No! Let's kill that rumor right now! Tupac was there! That version that you have, that's the original version. That is the version.
Okay, so Tupac was there when they recorded that track, NY87.
NY87, they all was in the studio. Can-Am Studios. I did that session. Tupac was there.
Why it was never released? Was it because Tupac passed away and the whole Death Row felt...
Well, you know what? Yeah, you could say that was a part of the reason. You know, because, number one, They were still pumping out a lot of material. We still had, you know, artists like Nate, who was getting ready to put his record out. We still have Rage, who was getting ready to put her record out.
Yeah.
Snoop was getting ready to release a second record. You know, so
OFTB as well.
OFTB, yeah. You know, so you had artists out there getting ready to do things. The Dog Pound, you know, they were working on another record. They were also working on singles. So during this time, there was a lot of work going on, a lot of projects in the making. And speaking in hindsight, if the company would have continued, you know, to flourish, and move forward, and we didn't have this tragedy of Tupac's demise. Yes, that record probably would have came out along with a lot of other records and a lot of other singles.
Mm-hmm.
Life is the way life is, and destiny is the way destiny is. We kind of live in the past, but in the future at the same time.
Yeah.
So what happened. It was probably destined to happen, and therefore, there were some great projects, great R&B projects.
Danny Boy great album and stuff like that.
Danny Boy's album. You had Jewel, and there were, you know, like the Six Footers, a male R&B group.
6 feet deep or something like that.
Six feet deep. Those guys, you know, I mean, there was some, a lot of good MC Hammer. I can't forget him. He had a record that was done and ready to go, you know. So again, now that you have this great body of work, who takes precedence? Who has more priority? And again, dealing with all these artists and everybody wants to be catered to. You know, so at the end of the day, it didn't come out because there was other, you know, priorities, other things that had to be done before we could, you know, address those.
Yeah, definitely. Do you have a funny or interesting story about you and Tupac, just a short story that you would like to
share? Yeah. My short story is me and Tupac were in Studio A at I think this is when we really got an understanding of each other and where I stood in the studio and where he stood. He came in the studio and he was doing some writing. As the engineer, I, you know, put the tape on the reel, and I programmed the Studer 800 to repeat. And Tupac's sitting up there at the board, and he's writing, and I'm setting up the mic. And this must have been going on for a good 30 minutes, and he's real chill. He ain't saying nothing. It's just him by himself. And all of a sudden, he jumps up and I hear, ah! And he's yelling, you know, and the vocal will come out, he starts cussing at me, and, and, you know, I just looked at him and went over to the studio machine, and rolled the tape back on, and I pushed play. And he gets quiet, he just, boop, went right back to how it was. Okay, at the end, he just quiet like nothing happened. I didn't say nothing to him. He didn't say nothing to me. At the end of the session, pulled me aside and said, look, man, you know, whenever I'm talking to you, man, you know, don't ignore me. I said, Pac, look, man, when I walked in here, you was yelling for a reason. You wasn't yelling for me to sit up and give you an excuse and blah, blah, and come up with stuff. You was yelling because there was a malfunction. You got my attention. My job is to be your engineer. The way that I can correct your rant is to put things back the way it was. And so that's why I just reeled the tape on and pushed play. He said, man, I like you, man. You be on your job, huh? I'm like, yeah, that's what I'm getting paid for. We had a great understanding. I worked with him every other time. See, because he had a tendency, and they say, you know, it's all in the zodiacs and stuff, Virgo and all of that. You know, he had a tendency of just like, you know, just being, you know, all this rage and aggression will come out. But then all of a sudden, it's just like, whoop, he's all quiet. And what that did was it intimidated a lot of engineers, especially, and guys wouldn't work with him because they're like, oh, man, this guy might fly off the hook anytime, any second. But like I say, you know, dude, man, if you're just doing your job and you just understand, this guy's just, you know, he's another human being. He got things on his mind. I don't know what's going on in his head, but I do know that I have a job. And the minute that you stop and you have to explain to somebody and blah, 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 all he really wanted me to do was come and do my damn job.
Exactly.
That's it. He wasn't looking for no explanation or whatever. Everything was working fine. Well, maybe something went wrong. I don't. He don't know what it was. I did.